Hundreds of thousands of Indigenous children were taken from their communities and forced into boarding schools created to strip them of their culture.
Our languages, our cultures, our practices were forbidden, punished if you were caught speaking your language, and sometimes even death.
The schools were the continuation of the federal government's efforts to take over Native lands and eradicate their traditions.
Their motto was kill the Indian and save the man.
It was a nationwide strategy that amounted to cultural genocide.
They'd bathe our kids in gasoline, cut their braids off. To us, our hair, it's our connection to the spirit. It's our connection to our ancestors. It is us.
To this day, Indigenous communities have to deal with the impact of 150 years of the boarding school system, including language loss.
There's mass amounts of abuse that has happened in those schools, and that's almost directly why we don't know our language today.
As a result, the diverse culture of Native tribes in the U.S. and around 167 of their languages are in danger of disappearing.
It hurts very much because they have something in their mind that nobody can replace.
Can these communities figure out a way to save their language and culture for future generations?
They say that those drums are the heartbeat of our people. That's true. And the language is our soul.
We're at the Yankton Reservation in South Dakota. Here, the community is reclaiming their education system in an effort to heal after the trauma of the boarding school era.
I just feel like I wouldn't be my true self without my language. It really helped me evolve the way I think, the way that I carry myself and look at things from a perspective.
Ternisa Konoye is a resident student at the Marty Indian School. Before the school was turned over to the Yankton tribe in 1975, this was St. Paul's Indian Mission School, a Catholic residential school that in recent decades has been at the center of sexual abuse and mistreatment allegations. Now, rather than being cut off from their Indigenous culture, students are required to take Dakota and Nakota language classes.
What was really ironic is that these schools were created to eradicate Native languages and cultures, and now today it has flipped, and now they're building on languages and cultures because they see that that's a strength, it's an asset.
Starting with the Civilization Fund Act of 1819, the U.S. government set in motion an era of forced assimilation policies, including the creation of federal or church-run boarding schools to separate Native children from their families.
My father went to boarding school, my mother. My grandfather, Dakota was his first language. He was punished daily for speaking it. Some of the stories he shared were horrific.
By 1926, more than 80% of Indigenous school-aged children were attending boarding schools.
So when they cut our braids off, they knew they were taking away our identity. They tried hard, but they failed. Because today, I am Dakota, Iwayedo, Dakota, Stodwayedo, Dakota,
Red Wing Thomas runs a Dakota language program at the Asante Community School. Marty is where he started his career in education.
Look, we have warrior things all over because you come from warrior people. You know that, don't you? And when we put those nations together, we have seven of them. They form something called the Ocheti Shakowin.
The Ocheti Shakowin spoke three closely related languages: Dakota, Nakota, and Nakota. One of the great challenges in keeping them alive is that most school-age kids speak only English at home.
So get hype on these words. Here it comes. Wohoda. There it is. Wonshida. This one's very, very important. Yuwonshida. Yeah, okay.
Young tribal members depend on places like this school to learn their native language.
Wohoda's respect, but not respect for me. Respect for yourself, and it'll show.
Red Wing has been teaching Dakota for nearly 20 years and says that teachers like him are constantly fighting an uphill battle.
The obstacles we're finding are within ourselves. We do not have enough speakers. We would have to first train speakers, have to teach speakers, and we're not creating enough speakers as quick as we're losing them.
Lavina Cook is one of 11,000 members of the Hangtawan Oyate. She's one of the few first language speakers left in her community.
I keep a list of all our fluent speakers at home. I have a logbook. It used to be up to 37. It's dwindling down. I have like maybe between 20 and 26 fluent speakers on our reservation.
The average age of Dakota and Lakota speakers is 70 years old, and there have been some losses during the pandemic.
It hurts very much because they have something in their mind that nobody can't replace. It's something that we learned as a child. We didn't have to go to the schools to learn all that.
The shortage of fluent speakers, according to elementary school principal Jolene Arrow, is only the tip of the iceberg. There are more reasons why it has been hard to find teachers.
The average pay for teachers in the state is somewhere like to $52,000 a year. But here, our base salary is like $34,000. It's really hard to get good teachers to come here.
Some of the challenges are tied to systemic problems in the reservation.
It's rough here. As far as employment opportunities, you know, we have two stores here. We have the school, we have the casino, a few tribal businesses here. But there's not enough jobs. There isn't. And you know, some of us have been out of work for so long that when you do have a job, you don't know how to keep it, because once you get paid, you're so excited and you know.
Even some people that are younger than me that know the language have a real hard time with alcoholism. We have some that went to school and everything to be teachers, but because of their, you know, lifestyle, they just couldn't do it.
We have so many talented people within our reservations, but a lot of them struggle, a lot of us. Struggle.
There were nearly 500 residential schools across the U.S. from 1860 to 1978. For several decades, Ocheti Sakoin children were taken from their homes and forced to attend schools like St. Paul's Indian Mission School. According to Red Wing, these schools are at the root of deep-seated traumas that have been passed on from one generation to the next.
Boarding schools, and their motto was kill the Indian and save the man, basically to rid us of our identity, our culture, our beliefs, and educate us in what was considered civil. Our languages, our cultures, our practices were forbidden, punished if you were caught speaking your language. And there was even a time where our older relatives who did go to boarding school were so ashamed of who they were that they didn't want their children to experience that. So what happened is there was a split within our own people, those who wanted the language and those who discouraged it now. And so that effort of assimilation is it's almost complete. To think about it.
The road to cultural survival has not been an easy one for the Ocheti Sakoin, but in recent years, Red Wing has seen positive changes.
My community here is in the middle of a huge awakening of culture and language, and it's the children who are driving it. In my 40 years of living, this is the most involved I have ever seen the community and the children, and it's really, really beautiful.
Charnisa is nearly fluent in Dakota. As a child, she visited camps in Standing Rock during the indigenous protest against big oil companies. She's part of a new generation that grew up closely connected to their indigenous roots.
I feel very proud to be Native American, know who I'm from, and I'm proud of the parent who raised me into these ways, and it's just empowering.
What do you guys say in the morning? No hihana washte. Remember that meme of Ice Cube? Can I get a hihana washte?
Teachers like Hehaka Elk Soldier are committed to the school's mission of increasing language and culture offerings.
They're going to live with our language and our way of life through this school, because a lot of them don't get it at home. And this is our identity. They yearn it, and they know that it's in here.
Indigenous languages can help children be resilient when it comes to healing from the traumas of the past or meeting the challenges of the present.
We have a big mission in front of us. The survival of our people literally depends on our language. Let's get beyond language revitalization. Let's get beyond it. Let's go further. Let's normalize it. Let's make it normal again. You know what I mean? Where we just speak.